Very good evening, viewers. Very respected special guest of this evening, Ms. Mahalakshmi, founder Women Entrepreneurs India, technical speaker CS Deepika, program coordinators from Karpakam Academy of Higher Education, Dr. Dharmaraj, Dr. Ramadevi, faculties of various colleges. Very good evening to all of you. On behalf of the organizers, I heartily welcome our special guest, Ms. Mahalakshmi Saravanan, and the speaker of this evening, CA Deepika, for this program. My sincere thanks to them for their valuable time today spending with the highly knowledgeable viewers. I also welcome all the viewers of the program to the fourth day of faculty development program. The organizers and I look back with immense satisfaction, having witnessed the phenomenal responses to our faculty development program for the last 3 days and the appreciative feedback from the audience. We are very much delighted for this excellent feedback and your continuous motivation and encouragement to the organizers. Today's technical topic of discussion is on yet another emerging technologies tool, blockchain business models by CA Deepika. Besides, we have lined up a session on how to develop entrepreneurship among the students by the faculties to be addressed by our special guest, Ms. Mahalakshmi. At this juncture, I would like to acknowledge the proactiveness with our special guest, Ms. Mahalakshmi Saravanan, priorities her thoughts and her power of communication. When I visited website of Women Entrepreneurs, being the founder of an internationally recognized social entrepreneur, her sharing of wisdom and advice to the viewers would be an inspiring session for the faculty, who would in turn pass on to their students. We have come across many entrepreneurs who have made it to the top in the business circle, like Mr. Narayana Murthy, the founder of Infosys, Mr. C.K. Ranganathan of Kevin Care, Ms. Indu Jain of Bennett Coleman. It is possible that one day there will be entrepreneurs motivated and mentored by the faculty attending this program after listening to the insights and the tips that our special guests would share with them. The topic on blockchain is a contemporary technology, a system of recording information that is resistant to any modification of the data because of its design and structure. It is otherwise a technology defined as the one distributed decentralized public ledger. It is considered to be the cost effective and promises to bring trust in transactions. It serves as the alternative to financial transaction without any intermediaries. More about to learn how blockchain technology business model works, the usage and the significant aspects of this new and emerging technology. We have with us CS Deepika, who will enlighten us this evening with her insightful address. I would like to quote, "If learning is an act of exploration, then technology equips the explorer for the journey of lifetime. Let us explore and apply with the newer technologies that come to play in the present day of business environment. Let this faculty development program act as a tool and as a gateway for the faculty to understand the newer concepts and technologies and disseminated amongst their students, who are the guardians of the future generation. In this good occasion, I would like to introduce our special guest to the viewers. When I approached her office to send her profile, I have received one booklet, which is almost 10 pages. I have taken one sample point for each page. Otherwise, it will take 15 minutes to introduce her. Whereas we have allotted 30 minutes only to her session. So, paucity of time, I will introduce her very, very short. She has started her career as a lecturer and worked for more than 5 years, then started her career as a successful business entrepreneur, having 13 years of experience. He has a passion to create better opportunity for women and been encouraging more and more budding entrepreneurs. She has become a role model for thousands and thousands of aspiring women entrepreneurs. She has been invited as a motivational speaker at various national and international conferences, industries, and corporates. After his motivational talks, more than 1 lakh participants benefit out of his inspiring speech. Her interviews have been featured in the leading South Indian televisions and published in various print medias. She is the recipient of many awards for her entrepreneurship and inspiring women. In the year of 2015, she was panelist at the International Women's Day celebration at World Trade Center at Mumbai. She has coordinated very many faculty development programs and she has presented papers in various forums. She has facilitated a session for the teachers from various schools across India at the 2 weeks faculty development program organized by the National Institute of Technical Teachers Training and Research, established as an autonomous institute by the Ministry of Human Resources and Development of India. She is a founder, Women Entrepreneurs India, and internationally recognized social entrepreneur. She is a TEDx speaker. With these few words, I am very much happy to introduce the great personality, Ms. Mahalakshmi Saravanan, to the viewers. I request our guest to share some of her thoughts. Thank you for this great opportunity.
Good evening. Thank you, Jalapati sir, for the wonderful introduction. I think you have covered almost all the parts in the profile. So first of all, congratulations to the Coimbatore branch of SIRC of the ICAI and Karpagam Academy of Higher Education for coming up with this wonderful initiative. I think this is the need of the hour. So many are a little confused. I think this would give a bit of clarity on how faculty members can support students to become entrepreneurs. So I have a quick suggestion for all the viewers watching this show. I'll be asking a few questions. You can answer those. Maybe on YouTube, you can answer the questions once you see the slide. And only two users have to answer the question. Once you see two users answer the question, then we can go ahead with the next question or the next slide. So please cooperate. So with that, let's go ahead with the session on how to develop entrepreneurship among students by faculty members. So firstly, so many colleges are taking up this entrepreneurship courses and are encouraging students to become entrepreneurs. We hear a lot about a student success stories as well recently, but a lot more has to be done. So I'm going to take you through a few of the slides here, and I'm going to share my experience on how the faculty members can actually create more entrepreneurs, especially young entrepreneurs. So next slide. I think there will be a lag. So before we go ahead with the slide, I'm going to give you 5 seconds to guess the personality. Maybe all the viewers there can figure out who the personality is without, of course, searching online. I'm going to give you 5 seconds. Can the users or the viewers on YouTube guess? I think it's already 5 seconds. Maybe 2 more seconds extra. There are around 52 people watching. Maybe someone can try. Okay, please go ahead with the next slide. Any guesses? Can anyone guess who the personality is? So I think still people are warming up. We are waiting for more information, I guess. So let me take you through both these slides. The first image was Florence Nightingale. She established the nursing college in 1860. And she is called a social entrepreneur. And the second slide you could see is Muhammad Yunus. He is a Bangladeshi social entrepreneur who won the Nobel Peace Prize. And he is a well-known economist. And he introduced the Grameen Bank. And people are actually benefited out of this Grameen Bank. And he pioneered the concepts of microcredit and microfinance. So next slide. So having seen the eminent personalities, I am here a budding social entrepreneur who is trying to impact the lives of many, especially women. So I think this quote you would have seen on the flyer, never give up on a dream, even if the progress is slow. So this totally relates to my story, wherein I started with my initiative and had to go through a lot to attain to this level. Next slide. I think there's one more slide which we have missed. Maybe you can move to the previous one. Okay, so here, when I started, there was a lot of fear. I think entrepreneurs especially have a lot of fear, and if they are not risk takers, I think it's very difficult to take that first step. So I overcame that fear and I really took that first step, and that's the reason why I have reached up to this level. Next slide. Yeah, here if you look at about WEI, I'm going to have two slides about myself and then we can go on to the session, because for people who don't know what WEI is, so this is the business I've been running since 2013, and my mother-in-law and myself are the partners, and she has won a state award for her literary contribution, and she's called Tamil Shemmal Kavidaini Maniarjunan. So mother-in-law, daughter-in-law duo is doing a great job for the society, I guess. Next slide. Yeah. So from zero level, I have got this international recognition just by grit and determination. We had to go through a lot of challenges, but I was prepared enough to face them and to overcome these. So from zero level, they've got the international recognition. From zero network, they've got a huge network pan-India. So now it is more like, you know, it's a community. A lot of people relate my name to women entrepreneurship, and we are happy handholding entrepreneurs to start, formalize, and grow their business. Next slide. Coming to the topic, how to develop entrepreneurship among students by faculty members. I think this is a very, very important question that we have to ask each and every student of your institution. The first question is, what's your passion? So way back when I was in the college, we never heard of the term entrepreneurship. Maybe business you would have heard of, but entrepreneurship was a quite new term. I learned it only 10 years ago. So it was a very new term, and most of our lecturers were focused more on the academics, and we were inclined towards academics. We never had a thought of business. We always thought, okay, we will land up as a teacher or a professor in a college. This is what we thought of, or maybe we will pursue higher studies. But what if people would have asked this question, what's your passion? Maybe things would have changed. So recently, I think there are a lot of colleges which have their own incubation centers or entrepreneurship development cells. I think they should really ask this number one question to the students who aspire to become entrepreneurs. There are talents, there are skill sets. But as lecturers, as mentors, I think you will have to identify the right mindset by asking this question, what's your passion? So it starts from here. Next slide. So when it comes to creativity and innovation, I think we are in a constantly changing environment, and a lot of things are continuously changing. So every time people have to innovate, or every time people have to come up with creative ideas. And in order to inculcate the creativity, I think we should give a lot of practical exposure to students so that they learn how to go about the whole business landscape. I think this important question on, are the educational institutions preparing students for solving real world problems? This is one of the main questions that the colleges or the universities should ask the students, because there are a lot of problems in the society and a lot of people are looking for solutions. If a student can come up with an innovative product or a solution, I think that particular solution or a product is going to become a big enterprise in the future, and that is going to create a lot of job creators. So I would urge each and every education institution to focus more on innovation, and also encourage children or the youngsters to come up with their own creative ways of solving problems. Next slide. So this is another question to the audience. So I'm sure I'm going to have the correct answer. Maybe audience, you can try answering this question. Which country has highest number of youth? Can someone guess? You don't even have to guess. So I think India. So congrats to the viewer who answered correctly. Yes, of course, India is, next slide please. India is the country which has the highest number of youth. Fantastic, everyone. So India has about half of India's 1.3 billion population is under 25. So please move on to the next slide. Yeah. So when you look at the youth population, it is like totally huge. Half of India's 1.3 billion population is under 25, which means we have got a huge asset here. All that you have to do is capitalize on that asset and help those young leaders transform into entrepreneurs, for which a lot of handholding is required. It is not that easy to become an entrepreneur. We have to handhold the students to come up with their own ideas. We have to mentor them at every stage. So coming to the role of the educators in inculcating the spirit of entrepreneurship in youngsters, you will have to remember one thing: good ideas aren't enough. So you will have to agree with me, because there are a lot of people who have very good ideas, but they're unable to execute it or unable to convert their ideas into reality. So all that you have to do as an educator, I'm sure a lot of people are faculty members or professors in various institutions, you have to start empowering yourself. If you can learn how to mentor someone, if you can learn how to manage yourself, if you can learn how to equip yourself with the requisite skill sets and transform the knowledge to the youngsters, I think that's where you start. So you have to have clarity even before you guide someone. You have to have the entrepreneurial mindset even before you handhold someone. I think you should experience entrepreneurship for at least a few months, just to know how things are demanding in entrepreneurship, how things change, how challenging it is, how prepared are you to face the challenges. These are certain things. So I would urge all the faculty members there, maybe you can take up specialized courses in entrepreneurship, or you can try to experience entrepreneurship by venturing into short-term business and see how effective it is, so that it gives you hands-on experience. So even before you handhold students, I think it is a good idea to empower yourself by exposing yourself to the entrepreneurship arena. So the first thing is that as an educator, you have to inculcate an entrepreneurial mindset in the students. And when it comes to inculcating an entrepreneurial mindset, I think motivation plays a very, very important role. You have to be motivated, and you have to motivate the students who tend to take up entrepreneurship. Because most of the time, what will happen is during the college days, students will be over ambitious. They'll be interested to start a business. They may be having the idea, but converting it into reality is like, it takes a lot of time. So you have to handhold them in helping them prepare the complete project report, guide them as to the current market trends, how the market research is done, how to pitch the business to an investor. So there are certain aspects or certain elements which the students have to have. And you should also counsel them as to how the students can face failure. Because most of the times, the students may be, afraid to take risks. So you can tell them that it is okay to start a business in the college days itself, so that even if it fails, it's going to be a rich learning experience for the students. And in the college, the students can have more exposure to the library, the resources, the online tools that they have. I think this is the best time for any college student to start a business, provided he or she has a very good mentor there in the campus. Or nowadays, you have a lot of mentors available who can do digital mentoring as well. The second thing is that business literacy is a very, very important thing we have to consider, because even today when I meet a lot of entrepreneurs, let's say, for example, if someone is into the creative part, let's say he or she is into doing artifacts or doing artworks. So they tend to lack the marketing skills. And one who is good in marketing, they tend to lack the creative skills. So I think a combination, some are very good in both, but there are a few who are looking for external support. So you have to build, or you have to help them attain the knowledge through webinars or through exposing them to all the financial aspects, all the marketing aspects, technology aspects, and accounting aspects, legal aspects. I think these are certain aspects in business which an entrepreneur should be aware of. So exposing the students to all these aspects will actually help them be confident in taking the entrepreneurship or the business further. And of course, the educators can tie up with the local entrepreneurial learning centers and you can have real-time entrepreneurs speak on various topics. That will give more insights on the current trends and how the students can actually learn how to go about the business. I think you can let the students interact with real-time entrepreneurs, which will give them more exposure. This is one of the important aspects that you have to, first of all, analyze, and you have to let the students get such exposure. And when I talk about creativity, people or students have to come up with creative solutions, because if you look at this pandemic situation, we don't have thought, that there are new products available. So now the leg-operated elevators and the leg-operated, the sanitizers are of great demand, right? So you have to let the students explore their creative skills and come up with a creative solution or a product. And innovation has to be there, because without innovation, you cannot find a better, the customer would always look for innovative products. If there are tons of products, and if you are one among them, you're not going to stand out of the crowd. You have to come up with an innovative product. So the faculty members can guide the students on the current trends, how the technology is evolving. I think most of the sessions, are on artificial intelligence. There are so many courses which are available for free on these technical aspects. So I think the students must be exposed to a lot of technology tools as well, which will help them come up with their own prototype. Students can make use of the augmented reality apps and the virtual reality apps, which will help them deliver the product better or come up with a better solution or come up with a product which will entice the customers. And coming to the mentoring part, so one of the major roles of the educators is mentoring. So we as entrepreneurs, when we meet aspiring entrepreneurs, we find that they lack in certain skill sets and they have to be handholded. So you have to identify the skill sets which the students are lacking and help them attain the skill sets or put them on to people who can actually guide them. So most of the time they may get, demotivated. So you have to motivate them. And most of the time they may not come up with a better product. You can guide them to improvise the product further. You can help them to connect with the investors, like angel investors or venture capitalists. So you have to build a great network. So when it comes to business, it's all about network. We say network is equal to net worth. So you have to understand the fact that you have to build your own network, and you can connect these students with the companies or the brands which are looking for such talented pool. And you can always help the students overcome their challenges through proper mentoring. And the final one is on the hands-on experience. As I told you before, the faculty members can also learn and get exposed to entrepreneurship. At the same time, they can encourage students to have hands-on experience. There are so many companies which are offering hands-on training programs. Maybe they could take it up. For example, how to create a project report, how to pitch their business to investor, how to go about the legal formalities. I think my co-speaker Deepika is going to talk more on the blockchain models and how it's going to impact the businesses. So you have to let the students gain the hands-on experience, maybe through internships or through project-based learnings or through case studies. You can help them gain the knowledge required to become an entrepreneur. Next slide. So the most important part of encouraging students to become entrepreneurs and help them sustain as an entrepreneur is to build a thriving entrepreneurial ecosystem. I think each college should have this in mind. Without a proper ecosystem, businesses will not sustain. So each college should focus on how to build a thriving entrepreneurial ecosystem. The first thing which the college has to think of is how to create a sustainable growth, how to help the businesses scale up, how to help the students grow from one level to the other. So as I told you before, if the faculty members are empowered, I'm sure they will pass on the information to the students, and this is going to be one. And then if you look at the startup, there are so many startups these days. When I visited a lot of colleges, few colleges have actually supported the students to become entrepreneurs by helping them with the resources, by helping them with funds. So you should look at the ecosystem in your college, find out how you're going to help the student, either by creating an incubator or accelerator, or by connecting them with external resources, or by establishing the industry institute partnership so that they kind of, you know, get to know a lot of happenings in the current business scenario. And you could organize a lot of pitch fest, because most of the times the aspiring entrepreneurs, especially the students, do not know how to communicate or how to present their brand to the investors. I think here is where the communication, the collaboration, and helping the students to gain the confidence to believe in themselves comes into picture. Here is where the mentoring part comes into picture. So you can encourage those students, and you can help the students understand the fact that when the local businesses are encouraged, they also impact the economy. So you can definitely help the student connect with the local businesses and help them come up with a product or a solution. So now all of us know the digital world, we are in a digital world, and you know the e-commerce businesses are the number one businesses, and there are a lot of businesses they can start without spending much on the resources, especially money. So you can first of all find out the businesses which you can start, which the students can start without investment. If they're looking to set up business with zero investment, you can help them. There are a lot of tools, there are a lot of online resources which can help them create their own applications, create their own software. So you can help them in that way. Or if someone is interested in food, you can help them get the licenses, help them standardize the product, help them in packaging. So there are different businesses, right? E-commerce, food, these are like number one. So you ask them to identify the interest. So first of all, you have to ask their passion, and then find out their skill set and the area of interest. And you have to really find out whether they are really serious in taking up the business further or not. I think these are certain crucial elements which each college or the entrepreneur or the educator who is trying to handhold the entrepreneur should think of, and help the student to become an entrepreneur. Next slide. So I would like to wrap up my session with this particular quote by Sir C.V. Raman. Real growth of a country is in the heart, mind, body, and soul of young men and women of a country. I think each educator watching this show should handhold entrepreneurs, especially aspiring young leaders who can come up with an innovative product or a solution. You have to let them know that money is a byproduct in business, and they should not be focused only on money. Business is much beyond the money. Of course, money plays an important role, but they really have to come up with value addition. I always say, when you add value to people, valuation will automatically follow. I think these are certain things which the educators can have in mind. And of course, we are a growing economy, and I'm sure the young entrepreneurs or the young leaders will definitely add a lot of value to people and to India as well. So with this, I think I'm done with the session. Maybe we can have a couple of questions related to youth entrepreneurship, or how you can encourage students to become entrepreneurs. I think professors are very silent. They are not asking questions. They are like, I'm looking for at least a couple of questions from the audience.
Audience can post questions in
Thank
the
you,
chat.
Thank you, Dharmaraju.
Want to interact with them, madam?
Yeah. I'll take two questions. Maybe once Deepika finishes her session, maybe I can also join in by 8 o'clock to answer a lot of other questions.
Yeah, yes, ma'am. Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you very much for your wonderful words. Really, it is a thought-provoking session for everyone. And
thank you, sir.
Your words inspired us, and it will definitely reach the target audience, students. And really, your words are motivating and gave hope for all our participants. And I would like to welcome our second special speaker on this.
Before you go ahead, let me thank the organizer. Dalapati sir, Karpagam Educational Academy. So thank you so much for the wonderful opportunity. I look forward to many such events in the future. So wishing you all the very best. Stay home and stay safe. I think there is one question coming up. Maybe
yes,
you have to 8 o'clock. I'll join you by 8 o'clock.
Please say. questions are raised.
So there are, I think, what is
your advice to Indian education system?
What is your advice to Indian education system?
I think we will go to next this thing, sir. Questions you will answer later. We will start next session. Yeah, madam has posted. I shall answer by 8 o'clock, yeah. Like that, as he has posted.
Okay, no issue.
You can start with the next speaker, sir.
Ma'am, welcome, Deepika, ma'am. Thank you for joining us. This is Dr. A. Dharmaraj, Associate Professor from Karpaham Academy of Higher Education. And I really proud to introduce myself with you. And you are most welcome, ma'am. Say, dear participants, she is Deepika S., Chartered Accountant. She has handled consulting assignments such as audit analytics, application controls, ERP implementations, information technology, internal financial controls, business analytics, and he's a co-opted member of Digital Accounting and Assurance Committee of Southern India Regional Council of ICAI, Joint Secretary of Women's Committee of Institute of Internal Auditors, Madras Chapter. She is a faculty with the SIRC of ICAI for Information Technology, and she has delivered many guest lectures in Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, Cost Accountants of India, and Internal Auditors of India, and in the areas of blockchain technology, such a specialist she is, she have delivered seminars, workshops on various topics like business analytics, Power BI, and R programming, and she is also doing her PG diploma in business analytics and business intelligence from Great Lakes Institute of Management. She is presently working with CNK and Associates. She was with John Morris & Co. as an audit manager. It is a non-banking financial institution where she was in the process of statutory audit, internal audit, and tax audit, and etc. She participated in various international seminars, workshops of various professional and management bodies in India and abroad. And she is also a district level basketball player. So really, we are proud to be with you. Welcome you, ma'am. I hand over the session to her. We people are expecting to learn a lot about blockchain business models from you, ma'am. It is new. It's not new, but we people are not having that much of experience or expertise with the particular blockchain business model, so it will be easy for us if you elaborate it in a practical way. Thank you very much, ma'am. I hand over the session to her.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the wonderful introduction. Good evening, everyone. It's a honor and pleasure to address all of you in this webinar today. So today we'll be seeing, I'm sharing my screen. So today we'll be seeing how blockchain as a technology has impacted the way in which our economy can run. It has the potential to change the way the transactions are processed, the businesses are running, and also impact the current economy. So let's go to the PPT. So the agenda for today's discussion is, we are going to see what is the basics of blockchain. What is the technology behind the blockchain? Is it so complex or is it so simple? We are going to see how blockchain is implemented in different businesses and what are the business models which are evolving through this technology. So this will be the wide coverage of our next 70 to 80 minutes. So I think all of you would have seen similar pictures. Anytime we see any topic on blockchain, there are a lot of pictures which show connected dots, connected transaction, blocks, chain. So what are they trying to convey? It is nothing but the way in which transactions are getting processed. there is a linkage between the way in which transactions are getting processed. That is, every transaction is going to have, let's say, a transaction of purchase. I'm going to have a seller and a purchaser. Only then a transaction is going to be a valid transaction. So what is the link between the two parties? So how we are going to establish this link? So blockchain is a technology which is built on the basics of transaction processing system. So we have several transaction processing systems in our economy, like our normal Tally, ERP, bank. Bank gives passbook. There also it records transaction. Insurance gives us premium paper. There also it records transaction. So what we have to understand before we go into the session is blockchain is not essentially Bitcoin and cryptocurrency. Blockchain is a technology where we are recording transactions. It is a method of recording transactions, how we are going to record the transactions, and in what way this method of recording transaction is better than the previously conventionally followed recording mechanisms. So why is blockchain required when we already have a transaction processing system? So as I told you, the entire all economic transactions, all transactions having economic value, like our banking, insurance, foreign trade, we have stock exchange, stock market, everything revolves around transaction processing, where we are capturing data, we are organizing data, and we are processing data. So right side, I have given the different types of information system, the triangle, which is in most of our IT books, the last or the base network, base type of information system is the transaction processing system or the TPS. So blockchain is a technology which has evolved from the TPS, the transaction processing system, to a very robust system, which will change the way in which business houses are going to operate. Not just business houses, the way in which we are going to operate. We'll see that in shortly. So is there any disadvantage in the current transaction processing system? Because always new technologies evolve over the disadvantages of the existing technology. So let's take an example. I am going to, I'm driving a car, I meet with an accident. So what is the first transaction that will happen? The accident is recorded. There will be a FIR filed by the nearest police station. So what is the second transaction that is going to happen? Let's say they have to meet for immediate injuries. They may take me to a hospital. Okay. What will be the third transaction? The vehicle which I drive will require some spares replacement and some tinkering. So now the vehicle will be taken to the service station. So these are three distinct transactions which are happening sequentially. So now, how does the insurance come into play? So I have to take my medical bills. I have to take my this service, car service station bills, and I have to go and give it to the insurance service provider against my policy. So there are, now we have two insurance providers will be there. One will be the health and one will be the auto. So once I give it, what they will do, the auto service provider again will check the FIR, he will check the service bills, and then he will process the claim by appointing a surveyor, again assessing the claim, assessing the bills, whether it's true or not. Okay, so the same thing will be done by the medical service provider also. So what is happening? There is timing difference in the transaction processing system. So FIR is a document maintained by the police service. We have medical bills by the hospital. We have the service bills or the spares bills from the service station, car service station. But there is a timing difference which is not matched to my insurance claim, because of which there is a huge delay in this insurance processing. Okay. And why there is a huge process? Because they want to, insurance company wants to verify data integrity. They want to verify whether there is any fraudulent claim or there is any error. Okay, insurance frauds are one of the highest frauds in India. So insurance will have a very big fraud risk assessment team where they will scrutinize every premium and every claim. Okay, and another disadvantage because which has caused this timing difference and the risk of frauds are disparate systems. That is, each one is going to have the separate system. Like my spares bill is going to be lying with only my service car service provider. My medical bill is going to lie only with the hospital. My insurance claim is going to lie only with the insurance service provider. So now, what will be a scenario when all of them are in a common platform to share data? Okay. Then we call them as peers to a particular platform. That is, insurance claim is one business process. Now we have different players. So each player is going to share data. So what will happen? There will be ease of communication, because of which the data integrity is also proved, as well as there will be no timing difference. Because now let's take, if they are in a common platform, what will happen? The accident took place, FIR is registered. So my car is going to the service station. So the first transaction FIR will be my initiation of the transaction, or the genesis block. In blockchain, we call the first transaction as the genesis block, will be the first transaction. So next transaction is I'm going to a hospital. So automatically, they may not wait for the police to come to verify FIR, all that. Automatically, just by having my ID, they'll be able to identify this was an accident, it is not a murder attempt, this is not this. So they have the data, they admit, they give treatment. Next vehicle is going to the service station. There again, they see, okay, this is the person, this is the vehicle, this is the identity, data is available. They will process the bill. Now, best part is for the insurance company. They need not apply any surveyor. They need not put any extra efforts in validating the transaction, because the invoices are directly taken from the service providers, and I am not giving my own invoices. So why they appoint surveyor? Because they want to know whether the applicant is doing any fraud, whether he is having any duplicate invoices or fraudulent invoices, such like that. Okay. So now all will be aligning to a particular model. Okay. So blockchain is nothing but it's a system of recording information in a way. It makes it impossible or difficult to change, hack, or cheat the system. Okay. So let's see one more example. I think all of us know the traditional stock exchanges. Before, the stock exchange was dematerialized. So stock exchange was just a marketplace where I come to sell my stock. Okay. So I am telling a price for my stock. So let's say I am selling my, giving a price of 50 rupees per share. Okay. There is a buyer for 60. Next buyer says 70. Next buyer says 80. So now I'm going to settle this transaction for 80. So the all the participants of the stock exchange, okay, are going to witness this transaction. Okay. So when I am going to sell this shares, it's not just I'm selling to him and he is paying me money, but I'm having witness of all the participants to that network. So they are my peers. Okay. So since this transaction is recorded by all their memories, okay, in blockchain, it is going to be called as a distributed ledger system. We will see that little later. But the concept is, I am transacting a product. All of them are witnessing. All the people who are the participants to that transaction are witnessing the transaction. So next day, there is no possibility that that person is telling, no, I did not say 80. I told only 70. This is a wrong transaction. You have charged me more. Or that person cannot deny that he had offered 80. Okay. So like that, we'll be having a control. We'll be having control over the transaction. Okay. So apart from the general control of the witnesses, we also encrypt the transaction. Okay. So here we use a function called hash function, which is used to encrypt the transaction. And as we saw all the pictures of this blockchain, it is sequential. All blockchains are sequential. So we have a block one will be transaction one or node one. Block two will be transaction two, node two. So it will be sequentially numbered and sequentially saved. Okay. So now since it's a shared platform, what we'll do is every copy of transaction which we are related to, we can download and keep. Okay. So now in our insurance example, does a medical company going to have all details of insurance? No. Is the car service provider company going to have all FIRs that is booked? No. Okay. It's only a need to know basis that the data is shared. Okay. But you are a witness to a transaction. So whenever you are encountering that transaction to be verified, you will be eligible to download and view the transaction. Okay. So this system is called distributed ledger system. So blockchain is a technology which gives a shared decentralized platform. Okay. So all these years we were talking about centralization, creating cloud servers, data centers where we have millions of gigabytes of data saved in one place and we all trying to access the data which is stored remotely. Okay. So blockchain is just the opposite. We don't have a central repository. All data is in the platform. All data in the platform is encrypted. All data is sequentially placed. The data integrity is provided because of the encryption hash which they are using. All the peers are validated for a transaction. And each one's data is stored decentralized in their system only. So it's like the stock exchange, I'm selling the share for 80. He is buying the share for 80. So every, let's say 500 people are witnessing this transaction. All 500 people will have access to this data. Okay. If they are generating the hash, they can download and save the data. If they have the hash, that is, if they have, they have the access, legitimate access to this data, they will also get a copy of this transaction. So we'll see this with a live example. So how they store this data sequentially. So this is also old concept only. So in data structures in computer programming, we have something called as doubly linked list. So what is doubly linked list? It is the manner in which every data is connected to sequentially connected to the next data using the header and footer. That is, footer of this data will be linked to the header of next data. Header of next data will be linked to the footer of next data. So sequentially, I am linking the data through a footer. Footer will be a common field. So footer of one will be header of next. Footer of one will be header of next. So that I'm able to link the data. Okay. So this is a concept which is existing since the age of computer. But now what is the new thing in blockchain in this doubly linked list is this links are encrypted. Okay. So how this blockchain is different from doubly linked list is the hash function, that is the encryption. Okay. So let's take this cat image is the data which I'm going to encrypt. Okay. So it's called a hash function. So what is a hash? So let's take example. I'm substituting A for B, B for F, F for G, G for H. Okay. So this is the five layers of substitutions I have done to create a hash. So every time I make write A, I will get H. Okay. That is the simplest hash. So mathematically, we'll create algorithms will create more complex hash. Okay. So for this particular image, the hash function, which is of 32 byte length, is this particular output. So we'll see how this is created. So is hash and encryption same? Will hash protect my data integrity? Okay. These are all very important questions which we want to understand. Okay. So let's take an example. I think all of us will have a debit card or a credit card. Okay. And a debit card has a PIN number. Okay. You lose your debit card. Someone goes to the bank. He has an insider in the bank, goes to the data center. Can he retrieve the password from the servers of the bank and then use your card to swipe and get money? No, it is not possible. Why? So hash is a one-way function. Okay. RBI regulates that all our banking passwords should be saved using hash function. So when we save using hash function, what happens is it is only one-way encryption. So every time you put your username, your card number, your CVV, okay, that password will generate a hash, and only that hash will get saved in the data center of the bank. Okay. So if you want to get, you have forgotten the password, you want to get the password legitimately from the bank also, bank will not be in a position to provide it. Okay. What is the best we can do is we can only reset the hash with the matching credentials. Okay. So hash is a one-way function. That is, you cannot come back to A from H. Okay. That is called hash. So encryption is, I substitute A for B, B for D, D for F, D for G, like whatever substitutions I'm doing, I can come back. If I come back, then it is called as encryption. Okay. So when I encrypt, what all data we generally encrypt? The DSC, we have digital signatures, we have encryption of mail. That is, I am going to communicate something to you, okay, and I don't want anyone in between to know that transaction. I don't want anyone to read the transaction. Then I'll be using encryption. When I don't want anyone to know what I encrypt, then I call it one-way encryption or the hash function. So blockchain uses this hash function to encrypt the transaction links. Okay, that is the most important part, why the blockchain's links are so strong and why it is unbreakable. Okay, so encryption has necessarily has a decryption key, and you can go back to the original data. Hashing is one way. You can never go back to the original data. Even if you try to break it, it will come only as a junk. So this is called as a system junk. That is, you cannot make out anything from that data. Okay, that is hashing. So now, how blockchain uses this hash is, we'll see the left-hand side yellow cube. Okay, so one side, like the center of the block will be the data. Okay, so it every data or the block, the transaction. Okay, every transaction will have a hash function. So a hash is a for our current example, we can like current understanding, we can call, take it as the digest of the transaction. Okay, we can call it as a message digest. So that is, data will be inside, but to access the data, you need to have the hash. So in our cat whisker diagram, it's a 32-bit hash. Okay, it's a simple 32-bit hash. So now, National Security Agency of America uses SHA-256. So that is one algorithm for encrypting. So Bitcoin uses one algorithm for hashing. Okay, Ripple uses some other algorithm for hashing. ICICI Bank uses some other algorithm for hashing. So we can use different algorithms, like different platforms can have different algorithms. The more complicated the hashing algorithm is, more foolproof your blockchain will be. Okay, so I'll have data, hash of my data, then I'll have hash of my previous block. So now we'll come to the green cube. Okay, so green cube is the first block. The first block is called as a genesis block because it will not have any predecessor. Okay, so hash of my first block is, let's say, 3z5f. Okay, this is linked to the next block. Okay, so my hash of my second block will be 7aq2. So like that it will go. So now let's say green block is my police, okay, who is accounting the FIR. Let's say second block is my hospital, third block is my car service provider. So each transaction, okay, is going to be one block. So these are technically called the nodes of the block. Okay, so who can create a node? Only peers of that blockchain, okay, can create this node. Okay, so this is our blockchain. We'll see a small demo. So this is a portal which is created, okay, to understand how this hash works. So this portal is created for understanding blockchain, where we can understand how hash works, how the linkages, data linkages work. Okay, so this is andresbrownworth.com. You can also Google and try. So now let's say I am the content of my data is today's faculty development program, 6:30 p.m. So this is my content. So what 260, this SHA 256 algorithm is doing is it is converting this message into hash function. So what is the peculiarity of the hash is every time I write this content, okay, I will get the same hash. So you can remember, okay. So I'm getting the last four digits is DD01. Okay, starts with 274, ends with DD01. So again, I'm going to cut it and I'm going to create, okay, I'll get the same hash, 274, end is DD01. So now you can go back. How we told every network peer will get copy of the transaction, right? So he'll be able to get the copy of the transaction only if he's able to generate this hash function. Okay, so the technology is that if the transaction is correct, you have the valid transaction in hand, okay, then you have access to that block in the chain. If you don't have the correct valid transaction in hand, you can never create that hash back. Okay, so now we'll go to the chain. So now I have series of blocks which I can create. Okay, so nouns is nothing but an attribute given to the block number so that the uniqueness of the transaction can be monitored. Okay, apart from the transaction, nouns is the characteristics which is attached so that the block as well as the noun should match, only then the block will be created. Okay, that is the transaction and the noun should match, only then the block will be created. Okay, I'll just enter a simple thing. Okay, let's say 1, 2, 3. Okay, and I'll mine for the hash. So once I, so generating a hash is otherwise called as mining. So all of us would have heard the term Bitcoin mining, Ripple mining, things like that. So blockchain is a technology behind the cryptocurrency, but it is not essentially used only for cryptocurrency. Okay, so we have generated the hash now for 1, 2, 3. So this also works in the same algorithm. So we have AD2. Okay, so now let's say I'm going to put here 4, 5, 6 and mine. So now I have this hash 3AD2, which is coming here as previous function, and hash of this function, okay, will come automatically here to this function. Okay, it's sequentially. It will keep creating the block, let's say 10 is my next. So sequentially, it will just creating the chain. So if in between, I'm going to modify one. Okay. So the entire chain of transaction is lost. Okay. You can only rebuild the chain. So if someone tries to tamper a chain or a record, the entire series of transactions after that will get destroyed. Okay, so I would have add a safe, the other person in the peer would have copy of transaction, but my copy, if I'm trying to tamper, it will be impacting all the blocks. So it will not impact all the blocks. It will just destroy the block in which the person who's trying to tamper. Okay, that's how I would say it's tamper proof. Okay, so now we'll see the next one, distributed ledger, where different users are trying to get that block. Okay. So here I have already typed, we have faculty, here we have development, I have typed, okay, so program, okay, I'll mine. So now this is a valid block I have created. So now this is peer A, let's say I am peer A. So now let's say Jalapti sir is also part of this network, blockchain network. So now he also has the transaction of this person, of my block. So what if he does the same transaction and if he is going to use the actual correct key, he will get copy of my block. Okay. So here if you see 77D2B is the last five letters, 77D2B. So every time I put the correct transaction, okay, I get the same hash. So if hash and hash tallies, only then it will take as a valid block. If an hash and hash does not tally, it will not take it as a valid block. Okay, so this it was a small exercise to understand how peer-to-peer network works, that is distributed ledger system works, and how hash works. Okay, since we are in one-way communication mode, any doubts you have, you can just put in the chat box. We will discuss it at the end of the session. Okay, so now See, I am taking more simpler examples first, and last we'll go to the currency, because currency was the first invention of blockchain. But still, the other parts of business models are much simpler and much more useful than the coins. Okay. So now let's take one example. Mr. Murthy had purchased land from Mr. Satya last month. Okay. Today he has applied to electricity board for change of name. So what is the process generally we'll follow? Okay. So when I'm purchasing house, I will be having a land registration done. Okay. First, I'll be having the deed, purchase deed from between Satya and Murthy. I will go and register with the sub-registrar office. Okay. Then I have to start changing all the names. I need to go for water connection, electricity connection, and whatever amenities I need for that house. Okay. So this, let's say government has a blockchain where every department is a peer. Okay. So now land registrar, okay, sub-registrar will be one peer of the blockchain. Then electricity board will be one peer of the blockchain. Let's say water board will be another peer of the blockchain. Okay. So like that, all the different departments of the government can become a peer to the blockchain. So when I go to electricity board, I need not establish title. I need not establish address proof. I need not establish my ration card, because all the data is already residing in the blockchain. So if I'm just showing this validity of transaction or the code which they have given me, identity code which they have given me, electricity board will be able to easily validate whether I have really purchased the land, whether it was registered, whether it is in my name, whether this change of name is valid or not. Okay. So government blockchain is also picking up. The UAE has come up with a strategy where by 2021, 50% of all their departments will be working on blockchain. Okay. Other governments like Singapore, India, they are also in the strategy for adopting blockchain. Maybe because of Corona, things may get delayed, but still it's a very good technology. So then just imagine what lot of time we spend on different departments and different places giving the same documents and validating the same documents will get reduced because of this. So let's try one more example. Okay, ABC Limited is a startup initiative by A, B, and C. Okay, they have received the FDI from Mr. X for $5 million. So I hope you are also aware of how the statutory compliances and compliances work in India. We have different departments, different designation, different people in charge of different things. Thanks to digitization and e-governance, lot of things are made online now. In spite of being made online, we have lot of papers which we have to submit to different departments. Okay, so now let's take now ABC Limited, since it has received some FDI, they want to change ownership. That is, the other person X also should be included. They want to change address. So what all they have to do? They have to go to the ROC, Registrar of Companies. They have to go to RBI for FDI approval. They have to change the GST portal, the owners or the signatory. They have to go to PF, ESI. So many compliances are there. More than 10,000 acts are there in India, and at least minimum 15 acts require periodic compliances. Okay. So now, if let's say all our compliance bodies are in a blockchain-driven platform. Okay. So once I file with MCA, okay, RBI will be able to take that, let's say now what will be the basic thing for this validation will be Mr. X's KYC, Mr. X's bank account, whether it is a valid transaction, who is the receiver, what is the money going to be used for. These will be the basic transactions which we have to get from Mr. X, which will be given to Ministry of Corporate Affairs, that is the ROC, Registrar of Companies, based on which actually we have to go for RBI approval. Okay, then after all this is done, GST. So now if all are going to be in one platform, as soon as we file one, okay, again, RBI need not take the pain of validating all the KYC of Mr. X, which MCA has already done. Okay, GST, because they'll have access also now. It's not just because MCA has done, I'm accepting. It is because I have access to the transaction. I have all the documents already, and it is also validated by MCA. Okay, in that manner, so PF and ESI will take only change in employee data wherever is required. Okay, GST is going to take only the company name change data, because GST is on transaction, sale transaction. Okay, this is only capital. There's no GST on capital. So they have to see only the master change, master data change or the name change. Okay, so like that, it will create lot of automation, a lot of time will reduce, it will create ease of business, ease. That's what I told. It has a potential to change the way the economy operates. Okay, so now when we talk about the way in which economy operates, we are, so previously we have redundancies, that is, there are so many layers, there are so many departments which don't talk to each other, so we have to take that documents to another department. So like that, we are going to have, we have lot of troublesome procedures and policies which we have to follow. So Indian government is bureaucratic. Okay, so we have to follow so many approvals, so many papers we have to give. So now if it is going to be in blockchain, what it is going to create? It is going to create transparency. Okay, it's going to create transparency between different departments of government. Okay, it can create a transparency between different service providers. Okay, in our insurance example, it is the cartel or the small consortium of people who are related to that particular business. When we talk about government, it's only the government department. When we talk about compliance, it's about the the companies and how the business is done. Okay, the business economy of the country. Okay, but will everyone adopt to blockchain? Because it's like data sharing. So when it's going to be government, whether it's going to be this insurance, all these are welcoming options. But if you, when you want all the businesses to come into blockchain technology, there is reluctance, because they, it's going to be like my business secret, how he can see, what he can see, why he want to see. I have existing systems which are much better. So there is reluctance on the businesses to take forward the technology. But other industries, like whatever we discussed now, are already in a very matured phase for adoption and conversion. Many of the companies have already done. They have successful implementation of blockchain in India. So it is implementation started from 2017. So we are in 20. So different portals have worked, different companies have worked on different things where they have implemented blockchain. Okay. So what are the different types of blockchain? Okay. So essentially there are two parameters, that is open and closed. Open blockchain is where anyone can be a member. Closed is consortium. If you are a peer, I have to validate. The blockchain platform owner should validate whether he is eligible and whether he can be part of the blockchain platform or not. Okay. Open is permissionless. You can just go and register. Okay. So open, in open also we have permissionless and permissioned. So permissionless is the cryptocurrency which we are talking about, the Bitcoin, the Ethereum, Ripple, the coins, where actually anybody who has money can just go in and start transacting. Okay. In public also we have permissioned. So permissioned is where you are also required, like you can participate, you can access anything. But if you want to change any document, then there should be an identity verification. Okay, we have given example as Sovereign. Sovereign is an identity management blockchain. We'll see shortly how identity management blockchain is very, very useful. And India is one of the country which implemented it first. I think 2 years before itself, India has implemented it. Okay, so next we are talking about closed blockchain, where we have consortium. Consortium means group of companies coming together for a common good. Okay, so there are two working models on consortium blockchains, that is the insurance and we have banking. Okay, banking, I think all of you will be aware of the settlements that happen, clearing house and how end of day. So bank operates only till 2, okay, for public service. After that, till 6 o'clock, they work on the end of day transactions, reconciliations, closures and all these things, right? So how that can be optimized. So those two industries are on consortium. Other industries also can come together on common good. Okay. So then we have private blockchains. Private blockchains are, it's just like CA Institute, CMA Institute, CW Institute can come together and do for the benefit of members share data. okay, or let's say group companies like Reliance wants to optimize their cash flows. So they can, what they can do is they can bring the entire group into one blockchain. Let's say in one company there is excess cash, another company there is no cash, but when there is no data transfer or data exchange or data knowledge, we will not be in a position to utilize that cash for this company. But now if you have as a group, okay, one platform where you are going to share data and save data and retrieve data in a decentralized form. So when I say one platform, it's not centralized. It's one platform, but decentralized. Okay. So as a group, they'll be able to manage their cash flows better and liquidity better. So like that for the better. So if in consortium, it may be you are joining hands with your competitors. Okay. But in private, it's not competitors. It's just you and your companies. Okay. So internally, bank ledger reconciliation between branches, parent and subsidiaries. So these are some examples of private blockchains. Okay, so business models which are evolving with blockchain. So many examples which we have discussed already, but still structurally we'll go through different business models in blockchain. Okay, I hope I was clear in my explanation and you understood the concept of blockchain and how blockchain works. Okay, so we'll see some business models which evolved in this blockchain. So first, in public blockchains, cryptocurrency is one big business model that is there for last 10 years. Okay. Next, we have identity blockchain. Okay. So DigiLocker is one example of identity blockchain. This is a blockchain I told, I was telling about, where the government has, our government, Indian government was the first one to adopt this DigiLocker. We'll see how that works. Then there is smart contracts, where when two people transact and want to enter into an agreement, how that can be digitized. Okay, that is some public blockchain business models. So in consortium, we have banking, insurance, energy companies. Energy company, energy is one major area where you cannot store energy. Let's say like we have 10 producers of electricity in Tamil Nadu. Okay. I'm 100% sure the southern belt, like Kanyakumari area, always have excess production, but they are not able to send it at the right time to the right place where there is consumption. Okay. So in energy, you cannot store it. So if all the energy companies come together and identify your optimum way of data sharing, where they can maximize the energy capacity utilization. Okay, I think some countries have done. India, I don't think they have already implemented, but some companies have done on energy. So there are different industries. In every industry, you can identify a way where you can build a healthy competition with maximizing the output for the industry or for the public. Okay, so consortium blockchains. So then we have private blockchains. So the accounting blockchains, where I'm going to have ledgers of different companies. So all let's say my suppliers, my customers. So if my customer and I are going to come into the blockchain, there is no required for audit, no requirement for verification, no voucher requirement, because we are both having same copies. There's no month end reconciliation, no BRS required. Okay. There is no, we have a debtor confirmation statement. We send to all our debtors and creditors, this is the balance in our books, please reconcile whether this is same in your books. All that will not be required. So apart from the block and the chain which I'm creating, because of the distributed ledger concept, I'm able to onboard all my peers also to the network, which is going to enable better transaction processing. Okay, government blockchain, we discussed actually about UAE going for blockchain. So generally, my supply chain management, let's say my Hyundai is there, okay? Hyundai is going to work with a lot of suppliers, small suppliers who are going to give different components of the manufacturing process. So all my suppliers, I can just include into a blockchain where I know my customer, my supplier, which product, which quantity, how much time I have. So this blockchain will be a substitute for our just-in-time concept. That is, when the production needs to be run, that time I should able to get procure that much quantity, that much rate, Okay, there will not be any carrying cost, storage will not be much. Okay, so this will enable just in time and effective stock handling process. Okay, so now we'll see detailed what is different business models in blockchain. So first one is cryptocurrency. So cryptocurrency we have not touched upon yet. So many of you might be thinking, what is this without Bitcoin? What blockchain class we are attending? Okay, so what is cryptocurrency? So cryptocurrency is a public blockchain. The hash, the block, the transaction, everything we discussed stands status quo for all the business models. Okay, it's only who is involved, who is maintaining, how it is implemented. These are the changes which are going to happen, okay, for different business models. So in cryptocurrency, what is happening is I don't have one maintainer of the blockchain. So now we spoke about hash. We spoke about 32-bit hash, 256-bit hash. Okay. So now for a coin, okay, for a Bitcoin or for creating that digital currency, okay, I will be having an algorithm to solve the hash. Okay. In cryptocurrency, the hash is not common for all the coins. It's going to be different. Okay, it's going to change depending on the complexity of the transaction. Okay, so person that is Satoshi Nakamoto, who was the inventor of blockchain technology, okay, used it for, he created the first cryptocurrency network called Bitcoin.org. Okay, he created way back in 2009. It's almost 11 years since this has come into play. So what he has done is he has created the first Genesis block. He created the algorithm in which he, the hash should be solved. So everyone who's going to transact, okay, someone else can hash their transaction. So now let's take our auction example. I'm going to auction my, let's say something. I'm going to auction a pen, okay. The pen, I'm going to price it at 100 rupees. So when I'm going to auction this pen, I have, let's say, 100 people in my gathering. So each one is auctioning for, let's say, 10, 20, 50, and at last 100. This is the sale price. Now, what my co-people are going to do is, they have to create a hash for this block. Okay, block is the transaction. For this transaction of 100 rupees sale to pen, they have to create the hash, solve the hash. More than creating the hash, they have to solve for the hash and create the block. So whoever is solving the hash will have copy of the block. Okay, so this is a distributed ledger system. So you'll be having, each one is going to have replication. So who, the miners are the maintainers of the public blockchain. Okay, so now when we spoke about insurance, it will be insurance blockchain. So banks created banking blockchain infrastructure limited. They created one consortium name and they started data sharing. So this is a public blockchain. So public blockchains are managed by miners. Okay. So what the miner is going to do is he is going to solve for this hash, this transaction's hash. Okay. If he successfully solves the hash, he will create the block. Okay. He will get copy of that transaction. Okay. Once he creates a block, what is the reward for him? Okay. He is entitled for a percentage of coin. So let's say one Bitcoin. The transaction involving 100 Bitcoin. So 100 rupees I told. Now we'll take it as 100 cryptocurrency. So commonly used name. So I'm using Bitcoin. 100 Bitcoins is this transaction value. So now when my miner is trying to solve this hash and add it to the block, okay, what will happen is the miner will get 0.1%, okay, or 0.01% of this coin value as his reward for creation of this block. So cryptocurrency is also called as self-regulating currency. Okay, so that's why RBI is little like India is little frightened in adopting token economy, where you can transact using digital currency. Okay, so what this token economy will do is it's called as a self-regulatory economy, where my hash, the algorithm which I'm starting with, I started with one algorithm. All algorithms will have finite solutions. Like in a normal hash, we saw every transaction is having the same output. Okay, here it is going to have different output, but all algorithms which is solved will have finite outcomes. So now let's say in the period of 11 years, okay, so many millions of transactions are recorded in blockchain. Okay. So there may be, there will be a point where a saturation point after which you cannot mine more coins. Okay. So after a point, you may have some variation to the algorithm with which you can create coins. So like how RBI is now managing minting of currency. Okay. Similarly, coins also are self-regulatory. So depending on the volume, transaction, and number of people, so demand supply gap. Okay, as based on the demand supply gap only, algorithm will be solved. If they are not able to solve algorithm, okay, then actually there will be a saturation and there will be no new coin creation. So economy will sustain with the existing coins. Okay, so I hope I was clear, but still. So let's take the simpler example. So we can take the same example. So I am the auctioneer. Okay, I am auctioning this pen for 100 rupees or 100 bitcoins to Mr. C. Okay, so now all the 100 people witnessing are trying to solve for this transaction hash. So once one person solves for the hash, what will happen is this transaction will get created into a block. So these are, as I told you, this hash is an algorithm. It's not like fully they have to program. There are tools which are solving for this algorithm. Okay, so computing power required for solve for these algorithms are very high. Okay, the miners will have a very huge system equal to data center. Actually, you can just Google and see mining infrastructure, cryptocurrency mining infrastructure. They will be requiring huge machines, huge computing power, because it's a very complex algorithm. So only it's a self-regulatory currency. Okay. So now whoever is mining will have copy of this coin. Okay. And anytime he'll be able to go to the previous block or the succeeding block. Okay. Based on this hash. So the concept, otherwise concept, whatever we discussed on the blockchain will remain as it is. The only thing is it is maintained by public. They are the miners. They are the contributors for the blockchain. And the hash will change. The algorithm is finite, because of which it is self-regulated currency. These are the major concepts which we have to understand in cryptocurrency. So there are different countries like Spain, Italy. We have countries like Russia, America, where actually token economy is an accepted parallel economy, where I can buy a house with cryptocurrency. I can buy some infrastructure, computers. I can use cryptocurrency as normal money and buy. So in our country, India, we cannot actually use cryptocurrency for exchange of goods. Okay, it will be treated like barter only, because it's not legally valid in India. So in India, what they do is they do trading of currency. Like we have foreign trade where we hedge on, let's say dollar, we hedge on euro, pounds, different currencies, how we hedge. So similarly, in India, what is valid is we can trade on this currency. We cannot buy any property, or we cannot spend or give loans in cryptocurrency, but you can trade in cryptocurrency. You can buy, hold, have some capital appreciation, sell. Okay, those are valid transactions in India. Okay, we'll move to the next business model. So identity blockchain, this is the most important and a very interesting blockchain. So let's take college admission, school admissions, recruitment, or employment, or even birth. What is required? Validation of identity. That is, we call it know your customer norms. Bank, if you want to open a bank account, they call it as KYC process, where they are validating different identity proofs. Okay, so this is a ideal example of a blockchain shared ledger concept. Okay, so what is identity blockchain does is you have an identity owner. So Deepika wants to create identity for herself. So anybody who sees her should know she is an Indian, she is from this college, she is from this thing, she is past something, and all these things. So now how I will give a complete data with integrity to my viewers. Okay, let's say now I Deepika is going to apply for a job in IBM. Okay, so now I'm giving all my college certificates, birth certificate, community certificate, so many things I'm giving to IBM for validation. So what IBM will do, it will go and validate whether these things are correct. Whatever I've given, is it fraudulent document? Really, this women graduated from this college? Does this women really complete this course? Okay, does she really have visa of this country? So it needs to validate. So generally what they do is they do a process called as background verification to see whether there is any fraudulent activity in my entire history, whether the documents I give they can believe or not. Okay, there is a process called as background verification. Okay, so one is you can do a background verification. The other is you can just accept the KYC, whatever we have given. But identity blockchain is creating a authentication mechanism for all your identity. So you have two more peers to this transaction. One is called the certifier. The other one is called the reviewer. Okay, reviewer, the relying party. So now I am the identity owner. IBM is the relying party. And certifier will be, let's say, RTO office who issued my license. Okay. ICA Institute who issued my certificate of practice, my college which issued my degree, okay, they are the certifiers. So certifiers come to the blockchain platform, okay, and I go and register in the blockchain platform. So all the relying parties, okay, can directly validate the authenticity of the document which I provided with the actual certifier or the issuer of the document or the identity. Okay, so DigiLocker is the first attempt India tried to create this identity blockchain. So if you have not seen DigiLocker before, okay, this is the DigiLocker portal. Okay, it is validated through Aadhaar first. So after that you can go and validate what are the certificates you hold. I have to upload all the documents, scan QR codes wherever possible, and create all the attributes to my document. So you have left hand side, if you see, issuers. Okay, issuers are my Aadhaar, that is my Aadhaar UI AI. Then I have Ministry of Road Corporations, New India Assurance. I have Income Tax Department to validate my PAN, EPF to validate my UAN, PF number. Okay, I have State Electricity Board. Like that, I have different identity issuers who are onboarded into this platform. Okay. So I have 161 identity issuers in India who have agreed to be peers in this platform. Okay. Next, I have requesters. So who are the requesters who want to validate this document? Okay. So mostly it will be recruiters, companies, colleges. So these are the people who will try to validate. So I have UTI Infrastructure Technologies. Okay. Some municipal council, National Employment Service, bankbazaar.com. Okay. So like that, these are the entities who have, say, Dr. Ambedkar Institute of Technology. So this will be a very useful, because even universities abroad can validate all my degrees and identity through this. Okay. So one more point is when I'm agreeing to share information, when I'm agreeing to be in a part of peer-to-peer network, even without blockchain, we can have such network, but it will not be safe. Okay. Even in a normal ERP environment, you can see some portals which is asking for your information to register. Okay, you register, like even Facebook is there. You are registering with Facebook to share your information. Facebook will share some information. So you are doing, but it is more on a very, it's not very strong data privacy and all. Okay, it's only what we are sharing, like we have some control over data privacy, but still it is not like a complete secure network. Okay. So when you want all the businesses which are operating the economy to come into a peer-to-peer sharing, the strong protection of integrity is the foremost important criteria. Okay, that's why blockchain is a very important technology. Okay, if you see Angel Broking, so these are the employers and Bajaj Allianz. Okay, these are the employers and other entities who have enrolled. Okay, to request for KYC validation of, it can be for their employees, of their clients. Okay, if a bank can enrolls with DigiLocker, they can validate PAN, they can validate their employees' data, or so many other KYC. We have KYC for so many things, right? Okay, so so this will be the documents I'll upload. What these are the documents which I issued. So only they had a campaign saying that if you have a document in DigiLocker, if you are uploading a document in DigiLocker and having it, then it will be treated like equivalent to having the original document in hand. So you have got caught with police for no license. Even if you don't have a physical license, if DigiLocker is showing that your license is valid and it is your name and your date of birth, the police will have to accept that it is true because it is validated by the RTO office itself. Okay, that's why they told you can upload all your documents to DigiLocker. That is, you are enrolling to be a peer in DigiLocker. Okay, so that is our identity blockchain. Okay, I hope this was clear. Okay, next we have banking blockchain. So this is also the next business model which has already set pace in our country. Okay, so I'll say you how it was first adopted. We had the PNB scam, right? PNB, we had a fraud that was uncovered, Nirav Modi case actually. Okay, that was relating to foreign trade where we have settled money to foreign companies, okay, without actual LC, letter of undertaking in India. That was a transaction. So how it has happened? Okay, it has happened through SWIFT settlement system. Like how we have NEFT in India, we have NEFT settlement, IMPS settlement, like that. For international settlement, we use a messaging or queuing system called SWIFT. Okay, so this SWIFT system is generally part of international trade. So the department is called foreign trade. Okay, so this foreign trade department, what it will do is it will share data with various clearing houses internationally. So I think all of us would have read something like Nostro, Vostro reconciliations, right? So the messages to this Nostro, Vostro reconciliation happens through SWIFT, okay? So internationally, they had 101 banks onboarded to a portal, okay, to a blockchain where they had agreed to share data so that the validity of the data originating in the CBS of the bank will be directly validated with the CBS of the other bank. So there is no intermediary required. Okay, there is no intermediary typing or so in PNB, what was the fraud was CBS was separate, SWIFT system was separate. Okay, they downloaded this data, okay, which didn't have actual settlement. Then while uploading to the SWIFT system, they added the data. Okay, so that was the crux of that case actually. So what happened was interface was not there. So here in CBS where there was different amount, but in settlement account, there was different amount. Okay, so to integrate this, what they did was they came up with a solution, blockchain solution for the foreign trade. So ICICI Bank, Axis Bank, Kotak, they were the initial adopters for this foreign trade module of the blockchain system. So there are a few other banks also who did it. But essentially, one more peer should be added if they want to clear 100%. That is the customer, the account holder. Okay, so if you see by last year, I think it is visible. So ICICI Bank, ICICI Bank is a, I'm no way actually marketing ICICI Bank. I'm just telling because they have implemented the blockchain technology. So they have onboarded more than 250 corporate clients having international trade, okay, for their foreign settlements into their blockchain platform, which they are part of the international blockchain forum. Okay, so for the bank to work in blockchain, it is also the customer also is important because this is a customer specific settlement, right? So I am settling under a particular guarantee which I have given for this particular person, right? So this is as on 2018. I hope the numbers will be much bigger now. This was the press release which happened sometime 2 years back. So that time itself they had 250. So they started much before actually. 2017 end itself, their CTO had given the press release on their onboarding to the blockchain platform. So after that, that is one way, one part of banking. Banking is a very huge subject and there is a lot of data and processing and business process involved. Okay, apart from that, we have in India itself, interbank reconciliation accounts, right? So every time CTS system, we have when every time we give a check, okay, check transportation system, CTS system, where how it will go to the clearing house, how it was split for different branches of different bank and settlement happens. So only it takes 3 days, right? So all that also can be made into blockchain, where actually every time I am recording your transaction, automatically you will also have that transaction. So instead of going to a common clearing house for settlement, you will be able to settle being in your office itself. So for that, actually 11 banks have come in 2019, in Jan 2019, 11 banks have formed this banking infrastructure, blockchain banking infrastructure limited, where they are agreed for this settlement based transaction sharing. So there we have a few banks like Axis Bank, Kotak. I think that news article also I had opened for you to view. So Axis, Kotak, and ICICI and 11 banks launched this. This is for funding also. This is for SME link funding. So every different SMEs are creating different project reports and going to different banks for different loans. Okay, so if banks are going to have a copy of the particular SME's ledger for different across the banking system, they'll be able to make much more informed decisions so that they don't give any potential defrauding loans. Okay, so those are all the business models which are coming in banking blockchain. That is, one is the clearing house and settlement process, second is the foreign trade settlements, and the third is the loan syndication process. Okay, so this is also a much evolved year. In as I told you, when we come to private blockchain or consortium blockchain, it is more difficult to onboard peers. Okay, but when we come to other public based blockchains like identity banking, things like that, we'll be able to it's easier to adopt. Because it's not like it's anyways, you have to have that minimum data sharing, which is happening across different industries. Okay, so then we have smart contracts. So this we discussed about the land registry, right? So you have buyer seller, you are, how you are going to create a smart contract. Okay, so that all the peers for that particular contract are also registered. So that is an example for smart contracts. So this is fully implemented in US. Okay, you like you can have smart contracts digital with digital coin settlement, like with crypto coin settlement. Okay, so this is a common practice now followed in different parts of the globe. So accounting blockchain, this is the most basic. So as I told you, blockchain is replacing the transaction processing system. So accounting blockchain will be record keeping. So let's say I am recording a value. Mr. A bought a car from BMW. Okay, BMW, let's say Kun BMW. So some company they bought. So now I am going to record purchase of car. Okay, Kun BMW is going to record sale of car. So if we are all going to have a common accounting system, there is no possibility of error. So there is no requirement of audit, where I'm going to go and sit and open the invoice which the car company gave and tick whether it is right or wrong. That may not be required because it's already validated by the issuer of the document itself. Okay, so accounting blockchain is also currently it can be used only in private companies. So there are more than 50 startups working on accounting module. Okay, just a normal accounting module for expenses sales using blockchain technology, but no big successful implementation in India because it requires transparency and transaction integrity. Like I won't share all my data to different suppliers or different customers, right? So that reluctance is still there in adoption of accounting blockchain. Okay. So insurance blockchain we discussed in detail. So government blockchain also I think we have discussed in detail. So previously it is a desk to desk, you have to have the process repeated. Okay, every department was isolated with no connection, but after the blockchain government system comes, so I think UAV will be the first one to launch because already some of the systems are converted. Okay, so it will be like all systems are integrated. So just by having one identity, you will be able to pass the transaction across different departments. It is not required for you to go to desk after desk or department after department. Okay, what is India's strategy towards blockchain technology? Okay, so Niti Aayog has released India's strategy for blockchain technology. It's a very good document. They have compiled various scenarios where they can use, where they cannot use, which will be the best which will be the best department to first go into blockchain. Like that, they have done a very good document. I think it was released in Jan 2020 only. Okay, it's a very nice document which we can download from Niti Aayog. So India's foundational infrastructures for blockchain. So they list these are the four important milestones that government has taken, which will be as a foundation to the implementation of blockchain-based government. So the first one is Aadhaar, where they have created a unique identity for almost 1.2 billion members of the population, people. Then we have the UPI. UPI is the settlement system interface, the IMPS and NEFT. Okay, that is the most sophisticated digital payments, that is syncing of all our NEFT IMPS transactions through one unified payment interface. So this is hosted by NPCI, National Payment Gateway Corporation of India. Okay, so that is one major transaction for banking. Then we have the GSTN. So GSTN, so as I told you, businesses will not adopt blockchain easily. Okay, they'll be very reluctant because it involves data sharing. So GSTN is a very apt portal which will enable data sharing. Okay, that is if I'm going to purchase. So let's say if I want to have an accounting blockchain for between my car showroom and myself for a purchase of car, it is not going to work because BMW is also not going to share their books. I'm also not going to share his books. Okay, but GST portal can do. Okay, as soon as he sells the car to me, he will record the invoice in the GST portal. Okay, after he records the GST portal, then I record as a purchase. Okay, GST portal will already auto-populate. So this is the invoice number, this is the person, this is the amount for which you have purchased. So only that I can take as input credit and I can pay. So GST portal is a strong infrastructure that they have created to bring in business houses into a blockchain technology. But currently there is data sharing, okay, in GST portal, but it's not blockchain. It's not integrated. Okay, I think 8 months back, okay, by January, they released something called as invoice identification number. Okay, which is you have to create a unique, like how in blockchain we have to create a hash. Okay, they created this invoice identification number, okay, for validating every transaction. So that invoice identification number is a hash of the transaction. It's not an encrypted hash, it's a normal hash. That is, it will conduct it will contain a few letters of the invoice number, the period, the month, something like that. It's a message digest. Okay, so but it's not a full-fledged blockchain network, but it has a high potential of converting into a blockchain network where all the peers of the business houses can come together. Okay, then this PMJ is the health insurance smart cards which they give for with government hospitals and other hospitals where you get subsidized treatments. So that is also, that is actually linking so many hospitals. It's linking almost every hospital through this particular thing. I think even private hospitals, they have to allocate some minimum number of cases under this scheme. So it's like it's integrating every hospital for all treatments. So that is also a very large network created for potential data sharing, peer-to-peer network. Okay. So who takes accountability for the block created? So in case of private or consortium, it is a blockchain owner. Okay. So there are different scenarios on which even Google has been accused for, like, as the owner. Google has been accused as a owner for a data for which is inside the website. Okay, that is, let's say I am putting some, let's say searching for why is Mr. President of US against racism, okay, why is for racism and not against racism. So now actually Google is giving some random outputs. Okay, so now actually if you want to sue for the data which is displayed in the search result, it is Google which is the data owner, which it is taken from different blog or portal. So though the original data was created on the blog or portal, whoever is hosting it will become the data owner. Okay. Same thing for the blockchain also. The host of the blockchain will become the data owner. In case of cryptocurrency alone, it will not have a specific data owner. Okay. So regulations in blockchain, we are just closing. We have different regulations in blockchain. We have different countries who have come up with different regulations on taxing the blockchain, taxing the blockchain or validating the blockchain, etc. Okay, so in India, what we have is we had regulation for only cryptocurrency where we had banned some companies. Okay, we had banned entirely cryptocurrency trading was banned from April 2018. But now in this March 2020, we had Supreme Court removing that order. RBI had given a circular banning it. So they have uplifted that order and they have told that trading in blockchain is allowed. Okay. So now currently in Indian scenario is you are allowed to trade in cryptocurrency, but you cannot buy. It's not a legal tender. It's not a legal tender, but you can trade. So as I told you, you can just hedge or buy currency, sell currency. So that is possible. There is no regulation on blockchain as such. Okay. So March month, even PM had come given a tweet on how you will bring in technology for regulation for blockchain, not for cryptocurrency. Okay, so cryptocurrency also will require regulation, but blockchain in as a technology was not banned or not was not banned in any aspect. It's only the cryptocurrency which was banned. That also is uplifted now. Okay, so key takeaways is assuming you have understood what I spoke and I was explaining enough for you to understand. The key takeaway is blockchain is a distributed ledger system. Okay, hashing is the function which is used for recording all transactions. It is a decentralized data management system. Okay, and blockchain is not Bitcoin. So I think these are the main points which we have to understand in blockchain infrastructure or blockchain technology. I think this was conveyed in today's address. So this PPT was prepared from various references and links given by different portals and different organizations. So I think we are on time. We can have some quick questions, if any.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Wonderful session. We have a number of questions.
Yes, sir.
I think dear participants, you can post questions in the chat box.
Okay, I see one question from Pavitra. How does blockchain affect in Bitcoin or cryptocurrency? What are the challenges in cybersecurity? So actually, blockchain does not work towards work on internet. Okay, it works on a separate network only. So it's like using VPN in internet, something like that. So actually, it does not have a cybersecurity challenge, but because the hash is the actual encryption, it's not just the access or phishing attacks, those are not possible. But what is the impact on Bitcoin is the transaction. Okay, the every transaction is going to be encrypted, so you cannot break the transaction link. So that is the main crux. You cannot break the transaction. So the whole point of acquisitions is black money is actually old acquisition of black money and parallel economy is that you are hiding transactions, you are deleting transactions, you are not maintaining books. Okay, you are just keeping fire to one building and saying books are destroyed. Okay, here the data destruction is not possible. So that is the main impact of blockchain on cryptocurrency. So then we have
on the screen, ma'am, how cryptocurrency different from digital currency?
Both are same. Both are one at the same. Different countries have used different name. Digital currency, right. Digital money, crypto money. Different countries have used different name. Yes. Any other questions?
Is there any chance of providing legal tendency to cryptocurrency?
Yes, yes, there is a lot of chances. There is a lot of chances because as technology moves and other countries are adopting, if India is not able to adopt and adapt to the new environment, it will be out of the league. So surely there will be a time when it is accepted as a legal tender, but it will come with high regulations. It will not be like now open economy. It will be a regulated economy where government will try to manage the mining. It will not be a fully self-regulated economy like our current digital currencies. It may be a more closed economy. Okay, next question we have. Indian economy, ongoing digital has been successful. Is it adaptation or adaptation? It's not all business, all digitization is not blockchain. So DigiLocker, this banking system, RBI is actually building a lot of very good software, sir. Actually, all banks' backend is managed by RBI. So any transaction you want to, like any transaction you access or you execute in any bank, RBI has a copy of it. So RBI is building a very huge infrastructure, but whether it will be in blockchain is not disclosed. Even GST portal, if you see, the entire business model of GST portal is aligned to blockchain technology, but nowhere they have accepted that it is a infrastructure, like it is an infrastructure built for blockchain. It's only this January we have that. Okay. The Niti Aayog paper. America has access to a medium of exchange. That's what, as I told you, currently it's unregulated. So yes. Once they identify a regulation, surely they'll accept it. They will not allow open self-regulatory economy. Yes, cryptocurrency can be a substitute for legal tender money. Can be a, currently in India, it's not allowed. If I have laptop and has any pillows and laptop, we will be able to get back my box. Sorry, I didn't understand. If I have a laptop and a hashtag, see, actually, there are different softwares which you can identify your device, but I really didn't understand the question. Since it's from Coimbatore ICA, I think we'll address this even now. Have you mind? No. I didn't mind. My friends have mind. They have benefited. Okay, my friend is only 30. He has bought a Benz and a BMW.
So we have another question. What can be the top 10 promising blockchain uses, use cases in India?
Yeah, I think many use cases we discussed. Mainly banking, insurance is the important use cases. If banking and GST is becoming in blockchain, actually the entire economy is in blockchain. It's like that. It's like bank and GST means both business houses and normal salaried, everyone's transaction will be there. So others will be only accessing this transaction and using.
Very active participant, Madam Amini Ammal, question.
Yes.
Accounting curriculum TPS is to be replaced with blockchain.
Yes, yes, sir, surely.
Sir, next question. What is your opinion? What are the suggestions to accounting curriculum?
Yes, sir. Actually, blockchain is, technology in accounting is very important, sir. So what we are understanding, the journal entries which we pass itself, actually when you go to an ERP environment, the journal entries are different. So you pass reconciliation journals and different ways are there. So I think we have to learn accounting along with the business process, not just with transaction accounting, with business process, procure to pay. What is the accounting for procure to pay? What is the accounting for cash to order to cash? So with business process, accounting and technology, these three, when we combine, it's a wholesome knowledge which will process the transactions for the organization. Yes. How does blockchain affect in Bitcoin and cryptocurrency? What are the challenges in cybersecurity? Yeah, this is the first thing I addressed. So there is no big cybersecurity because the hash is encrypted and you cannot, unless you decrypt the, there is no decryption actually. It's a one-way hash. Unless you solve for the hash and get it, you can get. Otherwise, it's not possible to do it. If you forget the password in blockchain. No, there's no password. No, there's no password. It's only the hash. Hash is the password. So you have to generate the hash. It is through algorithm. If you see, there are mining softwares which will have track of all the hashes you created. Okay, you can recreate the hash. So password concept may not be relevant actually. So even DigiLocker has two-way authentication. You have Aadhaar OTP and some PIN. So two-factor authentications are there, but it's not for the hash. It's only for access to the portal. So access to portal means we can reset anytime. One factor or two factor, we can reset anytime. But there is no password for the hash or the transaction term. It's only the recreation of hash which will be done.
That's it, ma'am. There are no questions. That's it.
Yes, yes, sir. We are on time.
Thank you. Thank you very much, ma'am. Very excellent session, and we are very it was simplified. And I would like to thank on behalf of ICI and also on behalf of Kathavam Academy of Higher Education, on behalf of participants. And I would like to welcome Dr. V. Ramadevi, Professor of Management from Kathavam Academy of Higher Education, to propose the word of thanks. Madam, please unmute yourself. Yeah.
Yes, sir. An ignited mind is the most powerful weapon on the earth, above the earth, and under the earth. And this is got through education. But a very good evening and happy Janmashtami to everyone present here. On behalf of Kathavam Academy of Higher Education, I, Dr. V. Ramadevi, Assistant Professor, Department of Management, deem it a great privilege and honor to deliver this vote of thanks. But first, I would like to thank the Vice Chancellor, Registrar, Managing Trustee, Dean, all the heads and professors for permitting us to conduct this FTP, 1 week FTP, in association with Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, Coimbatore branch of SARC. My profound thanks to Mr. C.A. K. Jalapathy, Vice Chairman, Southern India Regional Council of ICAI, for giving the inaugural address. Thank you, sir. My heartfelt thanks to Ms. C.A. S. Deepika, Chartered Accountant, for sharing her knowledge on basics of blockchain, technology behind blockchain, distributed blockchains, and many more examples which you have highlighted, ma'am. It was very insightful and informative. Thank you so much, ma'am. And all the nitty-gritties, whatever you have shared, thank you so much for your knowledge. My sincere thanks to Ms. Mahalakshmi Saravanan, founder Women Entrepreneur India, for sharing her knowledge on creativity and innovation, role of educators, how to inculcate an entrepreneurial mindset, mentoring, hands-on experience, build a thriving entrepreneurial ecosystem. Thank you so much, ma'am, for sharing your knowledge with us. Lastly, I would like to thank the participants or viewers who spend their valuable time in this program and hope they would have gained more knowledge on it. Thank you so much. And I extend my thanks to the advisory committee and the organizing committee for supporting us in this program. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, Divya, ma'am.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much, madam. We have a wonderful day. We are expecting at another milestone, our fifth day, which we're going to have a chief guest scientist V. Pundraj sir and speaker C.A. Joman and K. Jad sir for the topic of audit and assurance engagement. I would like to welcome all the participants and make it useful for you. Thank you very much. Good night. Thank you.
Good night, sir. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.